how are you all? Hope you all are fit and fine. This is Gayatri. Welcome you all to BioSchool. In the last session, we have discussed about C. elegans, fertilization, cleavage, and the formation of dorsal ventral as well as the left and the right axis. In today's video, we will see how the anterior and posterior axis formed in C. elegans. You know, the C. elegans is used as a model organism and it is a very important topic. So please watch the video till the end. So let's know which factors determine the anterior and posterior axis formation in C. elegans. You know that the C. elegans are the free living soil nematodes, which are commonly known as the roundworm. And it is very well known for its the rapid period of embryogenesis, which is completed within the 16 hours. And that process, it can be completed in the petri dish. It produces the relatively few cell types. In the earlier life, the C. elegans are the males, but in the later in the life, their eggs are the produced, and the adult C. elegans are the known as the hermaphrodite, as the individual produce both the sperms and eggs. Now we'll see the formation of the anterior and posterior axis of the C. elegans. The decision as to which end will be the anterior and which one will be the posterior, that depends on the position of the sperm pronucleus. Okay, that depends on the position of sperm pronucleus. So when it enters the oocyte cytoplasm, in C. elegans, the sperm enter the egg in the posterior side. Okay, so when it enters the oocyte cytoplasm, what will happen? The centriole associated with the sperm pronucleus initiate the cytoplasmic movement, and that cytoplasmic movement that push the male pronucleus to the nearest end of the oocyte. Okay, and that end, it becomes the posterior pole. The integration of the cell division, cell specification and morphogenesis, it is coordinated by the sperm and the several PAR proteins. Okay, so the CYK4 from the sperm cytoplasm, it activates the egg microfilament to reposition the PAR proteins and push them anteriorly. Okay, so now the egg pronuclei, it is in the anterior end, and the sperm pronuclei in the posterior end. If the females are mated with the male whose CYK4 has been knocked down. Okay, if the female is mated with the male whose CYK4 is knocked down, then what will happen? It will result in the embryo that lacks the polarity. Okay, that lacks the polarity of the anterior and the posterior axis, and the embryo, it will be dead. Now we'll see the PAR protein and is the role in the establishment of anterior and the posterior axis. Okay, so which type of PAR protein are present in the posterior end and which are present in the anterior end? Okay, so when the past the sperm, it enters into the egg, what will happen? The egg nucleus, it will undergo the process of the meiosis. It will start the process of meiosis at the anterior end. And the cortical cytoplasm is this one, this orange color, it is known as the cortical cytoplasm. This cortical cytoplasm, it contains the PAR protein, that is the PAR3, PAR6 and PKC3. Okay, and the internal cytoplasm, this is the internal cytoplasm, which is marked by the purple color dots. This internal cytoplasm, it contains the PAR protein, that is the PAR protein 2 and PAR protein 1, PAR 2 and the PAR 1. So the cortical cytoplasm, it contains the PAR3, PAR6 and the PKC3. Whereas the internal cytoplasm, which is marked by the purple colored dots, that contains the PAR protein 2 and PAR 1. The PKC3, which is present in the cortical cytoplasm, it restricts the PAR 1 and PAR 2 to the internal cytoplasm by phosphorylating them. So initially, what will happen? The PKC3, which is present in the cortical cytoplasm, by phosphorylating the PAR1 and the PAR2, it prevents the PAR1, PAR2 to enter into the internal cytoplasm. So in the next step, what will happen? When the microtubules of the sperm centrosome, it initiates the contraction of actin-based cytoskeleton toward the future anterior side of embryo. Okay, then the sperm microtubule, this sperm microtubule, it also protect the PR2 protein from phosphorylation by PKC3, because the PKC3, it phosphorylate the PR2 protein and restricts it enter into the internal cytoplasm. So when the sperm centrosome, it not only initiate the contraction of 18 based cytoskeleton toward the interior side, but also it protect the PAR protein from phosphorylation. Okay, so that it allow entering into the cortex along with its the partner PAR1. Okay, then the PAR1, it will phosphorylate the PAR3 protein. You know where the PAR3 protein is present? It is found in the cortical cytoplasm. And after the phosphorylating the PAR3 by the PAR1, that cause the PAR3 and is the binding partner. The binding partner of PAR3 is PAR6. Okay, PAR6 and the PKC3 to leave the cortex. So what will happen? See, this one is the cortical cytoplasm. This one is the internal cytoplasm. So once the PAR2 protein enter the posterior cortex, then it will phosphorylate the PAR3. It will PAR2. It will phosphorylate the PAR3 and cause the PAR3 and is the binding partner and cause the PAR3 and the binding partner. What are the binding partner of PAR3? The binding partner of PAR3 are the PAR6 and the PKC3. Okay. And it caused the PAR2 protein, it caused the PAR3 and its binding partner PAR6 and the PKC3 to leave the cytoplasm. Okay, like to leave the internal cytoplasm, leave the cortex. So the posterior cell becomes defined by the PAR2 and PAR1. So now the posterior end has only the PAR1 and the PAR2, and the interior cell becomes defined by the PAR6 and the PAR3. Okay, as the metaphase plate is the asymmetric and the microtubules are closer to the posterior pole, metaphase plate separates the zygote into two cells having the interior parts and another one having the posterior parts. So here you see the PAR proteins, how they play the role in establishment of the interior and the posterior axis. Okay, so the interior axis has the PAR protein, that is the PAR3 and the PAR6, whereas the posterior end has the proteins, that is the PAR1 and the PAR2. Now we'll see the pea granules. The pea granules, it is one of the important PAR protein. Okay, that is known as the pea granules. It is a ribonucleoprotein complex, and the role of the pea granule is to specify the germ cells. Okay, what is the role of pea granules? Its role is to specify the germ cells. The protein of these granules are the RNA helicase. They are the poly-A polymerase and the translation initiation factors. So what will happen just after the fertilization, the randomly scattered pea granules, it will move to the posterior end of the zygote. Okay, why it moves to the posterior end of the zygote? By moving to the posterior end of the zygote, enter only the P1 cell. Okay, the posterior interior end is the AB cell and the posterior end is the stem cell is the P1 cell. Okay. The pea granule from the P1 cell remain in the posterior of the P1 cell. Okay, it remain in the P1 cell, but when it divide, thereby it will pass to the P2 cell, similarly then to the P3 cell, and eventually the pea granule, it will be resides in the P4 cell. And we know that the P4 cell, and it gives rise the germline cells in the adults, that are the sperms and eggs. So the pea granule, it plays the important role in specifying the germ cell. So in this session, we have learned about the interior posterior axis formation in the C. elegans, the role of a PAR protein in the formation of interior and the posterior polarity, as well as the pea granules that help in the formation of the germ cells. I'm sure that this will definitely help you in your preparation. If you like this video, then please share and subscribe. थैंक यू।